Goedemiddag allemaal. En nou, welkom weer met z'n allen bij elkaar. Ik hoop dat jullie er tot nu toe van genieten. Even wat geluid, hè? Even kijken. Hebben jullie het naar je zin vandaag? Ja? Oké, nou ja, het is redelijk enthousiast. Kan beter. Misschien dat het nog komt gedurende deze sessie, ik hoop het. Ik vind het een ontzettend spannend moment, want straks gaat er iets gebeuren wat ik nog nooit heb meegemaakt. Dus daar ben ik heel benieuwd naar. We krijgen zometeen Ken Schwaber op het podium. Dat betekent ook dat ik naar het Engels ga switchen, want anders kan hij mij vrij lastig verstaan. Wat verder goed is om te weten, ik zal kort Ken introduceren. Wat er gaat gebeuren is, hij heeft een heel mooi verhaal voorbereid. Dat gaat uiteraard over Scrum. Het is wel handig om, maar goed, ik heb Ken even in het voorpraatje heb ik doorgegeven dat jullie de beste groep ooit zijn. En ik heb hem verteld dat jullie al wel op zijn minst enige ervaring hebben, kennis hebben genomen van iets wat met Scrum te maken heeft. Dus hij gaat zijn verhaal daarop aanpassen en echt weer een volgende stap zetten in zijn gedachten. En ik denk dat heel inspirerend zal zijn voor jullie. Na zijn presentatie is er de mogelijkheid voor jullie om hem live vragen te stellen. Live in de zin dat, hij kan jullie niet zien, maar jullie hem wel en zijn reactie en allemaal dat soort zaken. Dat is wel letterlijk live wat er in Boston op dat moment gebeurt. Volgens mij te gek. Ik denk dat alles klaar staat om te kunnen beginnen. Dus als ik van jullie een ontzettend groot applaus mag, dan komt, als het goed is, nu naast mij Ken Schwaber. Hi, Ken.
Hello. Is it time to start?
Can you hear me, Ken?
Yes.
Right.
I can.
You can. That's awesome. At this moment, you're live on stage with me, just next to me as we speak. So the audience is here. And, well, we already did some round of applause for you having you here on stage in Noordwijk, which is a great honor for us. I don't think, Ken, that you
are... Isn't it amazing that I can be right there with you?
The audience says yes, Ken. So they are pretty excited. I hope as much as I am. I see also lots of lights from I would say phones. So there's something happening over here. I'm not sure what you will get out of it, but well, lots of photos are taken at this moment. So I think this is a good moment that we have now. Yes.
Excellent. So, as said, I'm Ken Schwaber, and this, I understand, will be the last talk for the day. And what I'd like to talk to you about is gaining innovative ability and efficiency with Scrum. So Scrum itself is not a goal. It's simply a technique or a framework you can use to become innovative or to become far more efficient than you are now. And as such, it is a competitive advantage and a competitive reason that many organizations yearn for and look forward to. So I have a little quote there from one of my favorite authors, Mark Twain. And I find that when I remember it, it helps me get through the day. That if you eat a frog first in your day, nothing else will seem as bad. Now, what I wanted to talk to you about was you want.
You already started your presentation, right? Or
yes.
Is this? Yes, very good. That's great because, well, instead of your presentation, I guess it's still me standing on stage here. So that's something we did not do very properly, maybe in the short thing we had previously. So what we will do, Ken, from our side is I will get off the stage as soon as possible to give you all the space for the presentation that you will give. So thanks a lot for being here and taking the time to inspire us. And I would say, take it away. Thank you.
So we are ready to start now? Yes. So the talk that I'd like to have with you is about innovation, innovative ability, and efficiency in an organization. And this is far more critical now than when we started with Scrum 20-some years ago, when you wouldn't find companies coming out with new products like Spotify within a very short time frame. It used to take companies a long time, but no more, because organizations have gained an ability to innovate rapidly, and this is called agility. Now, I think the Netherlands was one of the first places where I first visited and talked with people about Scrum back in 1999, very, very early. And we have used many, many people and trainers and coaches and acolytes to talk with people about Scrum. So Scrum has actually been introduced as a concept, as a framework, as a way of doing things into almost all IT organizations, and certainly in software houses or independent software vendors that rely on selling software for a profit to stay in business. So almost everyone's familiar with it. However, Scrum is very, very analogous to playing chess. That is, you can look at it, you can study it, you can read the Scrum guide, you can read a quick description of chess that the knight can only go 2-1 or 1-2. But that doesn't mean that you can build good software with it or play a good chess game with it. And many organizations that have tried to adopt Scrum and tried to apply it to critical situations or tried to gain agility throughout have gained maybe some of the benefits, but it certainly creates confusion because Scrum and the principles that it's based on and its values are often very different from what the organization has been like before. And we'll talk a little bit about that, because that often is your biggest challenge. It's not using Scrum. It's helping people understand a different way of thinking. And because of this, most organizations that were building software before used what we called the waterfall or the predictive method. And they're trying to shift to an agile approach, which is Scrum. And many of them have stalled. That is, they've gotten some of the benefits, but they certainly haven't gotten all the benefits that they were hoping for. And worse yet, some of the confusion is still persistent. So that's what we're going to talk about. And what I need to know from you is for you to think about your needs. That is, here's a day where you've been thinking and talking about Scrum and Agile. Some people in your organization have had you think about it and come to this event to learn more. But what success has your organization reaped so far from Scrum and Agile? That is, how is it better? Has it put out software more quickly? Has it improved its quality? Has its technical debt gone down? Have people flocked to your organization because they want to work at a place like this? So if you have, then you might have some successes, but then you might be also wondering, we have some successes, but why haven't these spread on their own? That is, if this makes sense, why aren't people just automatically doing this and it's just happening everywhere and I don't need to keep helping them keep pushing? And that is because Scrum is different from a waterfall. Agile is different from predictive or traditional approaches. And change is probably the hardest thing to do in the world. It's so easy to pat yourself on the back in the morning when you wake up and say, oh, I'm a really great guy or girl, and everything I do is fine. But to instead wake up and say, got to really start thinking about how I can do things differently because I have an insight that if I do it this way, so it will be better. So one of the things you might want to think about and that we'll talk about is what are the biggest obstacles that you might face in using Scrum and becoming agile and innovative as an organization. what are these obstacles and what sort of things might you expect? Because it's not reading the Scrum Guide. It's not even buying a book and reading about it. It's not even just going to a conference. Change comes, as all of you know, who have decided to suddenly become fit and run a 4-minute mile through hard work. So some people have different approaches to making Scrum and Agile spread through the organization. And so we'll also talk a little bit about what possible solutions are you investigating. And I've categorized them into 4 major groups. And we'll just look at them and see strengths and weaknesses of each one. Now, each a way of doing things, a way in which you have values, a way in which you automatically approach a problem, is called a culture. And so, for instance, if you are interviewing someone and you talk to them, you can often get a sense of whether they will fit into your organization or not. And what that really is sensing is whether they are going to fit into your culture, your way of thinking, your way of seeing things, your ways of approaching things. And what we're doing with Scrum and Agile is coming up with a new way of seeing and doing things. In the traditional way, and it's much worse for back in 1995 when I started traveling around the world doing this, perhaps that was before some of you were born even, but there it is. The traditional approach was waterfall. And in a waterfall project, the way of knowing that you are successful is you have a project and you have a project plan. And when you're done, all of the requirements have been delivered in working software. And the project ends on a planned date. So at the start of the project, you say, we will be done in 18 months. And you are. And also you project and you say, and we will not spend more than $72 million. And you don't. That's your budget. Not only that, but you lay out a plan and staff the plan and the project follows the plan. So this is success. Now, of course, the world changes during while the project is going on. And so your customers, the business, come up with changes, things that they hadn't thought of before, things that they now need to have accommodate. And you're able to adapt those within the framework that of your project. Of course, you still have to stay on budget and on plan and deliver on the date. Now, Agile is very, very different from that. The presumption in a traditional or waterfall project is that if you meet those criteria, you are successful. In Scrum, in Agile, the presumption is if you do something that creates value in the marketplace and for your company, and you can build on it, you have done something that is successful. The way you do it, up to you, depends upon the circumstance, depends upon the situation. Now, what this means is you have to think. You have to be a person who inspects what's going on and makes adaptations and does the best they can. So in Agile, success is a way in which we optimize value. So when we deliver working software, it is valuable to the organization. And also that we start with the most valuable things and we deliver them 1, 2, 3, 4. And maybe we don't even deliver or talk about the things which we had talked about before, but really it turns out aren't very valuable. So we focus on value and the most valuable things to do. And this is the other thing that's just kind of strange is quality is inherent in the process. In many of the old automotive lines, in many of the old ways of building software, you built something and then you saw if it worked. That's called quality control. In Scrum, you build quality in throughout the entire process. You don't build it in, you don't test at the end. If I see it, I know it'll work. Elon Musk, the founder of Tesla, shocked the world the other day when he said that the Model 3 was going to be ready for delivery in 2 months. And no, he wasn't going to have a beta testing phase because their process of developing the car and the software that runs it, which is pretty extensive, has already had the testing and the quality validated. The other thing which is really weird about this is the primary thing that's valued in a Scrum project, in an Agile project, is that the staff and the customers are valued. The people who are doing the work are actually the people who know how to do the work, so we listen to them and get their ideas. The people who are going to use what they're building are the customers. And so, of course, we're constantly showing them what we have, and we're constantly showing them what could be, and we're taking their ideas in. So maybe even what was most valuable at the start turns out not to be as valuable as we thought, and we start changing the project and the goals and the ideas of this as we go. So often, when you're done with a Scrum initiative, you may have delivered something that's radically different from what you thought might be the possibility. An example we might have is Uber or Lyft. Who would have guessed that you'd turn most of the people in the city into taxi drivers in their spare time? And yet this has really taken off, and now it's being adopted by major car companies. So this ability to innovate, to take advantage of new insights and new ideas and new technology, is the essence of Scrum, is the essence of Agile, and as we've seen over the last 5 years in our society, it's the essence of organizational survival. Now, you as a person come to work, right? And you, of course, want to be successful at work. If you are married, you may have a family, and they, of course, want you to be successful because they may count on you for money to buy food, to, you know, create housing. So you want to be successful, and you want to feel good about yourself, and you want to take care of those who count on you. Now, if you are in a waterfall organization, a traditional software development organization, the way to get promoted, and that typically promotion gives you a better title, like from a director to a vice president, and with each title increase, you get more money. And the way of doing that is to avoid failures, or if there's a failure, obscure it. Because no one wants to promote a failure. They say, oh man, that guy failed here and failed there and failed there, and we don't want another failure. The other thing that you can do is when you commit to doing something to someone, then you give them a date, you say these are the requirements, and you give them a budget, that you deliver what you said you would. And the other trick, and this is inherent in the people who are best at this, is the idea of plausible deniability. Unfortunately, in our world, failure does happen. And what plausible deniability means is you find a way to shift the blame onto someone else. So you sit there and you're very sad that it failed, but not your problem. And you as a person spend your time managing upwards. That is worrying about what your management and your executives are thinking about you rather than managing downwards, which is thinking about what you can do to help the people who work for you do better. And the last thing which relates to all of these is to avoid risk. Now, if you want to be innovative, you can't do these things. You will occasionally fail. You are going to take on risks. Some of the projects may not work. Some of the products may not be viable. But you have to find out. You have to try because everyone else is. So what Agile supports is a set of ways of acting which are very different than those that a traditional person who works in an organization might be used to. So we ask them to maximize the value of what they're going to deliver, controlling risk, but the main focus is do the most important things. We ask them not to worry about themselves getting promoted, but instead worry about getting rewards, benefits, accolades, and value to the people doing the work, because they're the ones who are actually, you know, coming up with the creative ideas. Another thing that we want to do is we want to maximize communication so there are no surprises. We want to be open. We want to be transparent. And this way, you may find that other people you're working with have insights into what you're thinking that really shock you and cause you to do things in a different way than you otherwise would have. We expect to have failures. Now, in Scrum, we work in short cycles. So let's say maximum a month, maybe 2-week cycles. So what we do to contain and control our failures is we only take in, let's say, a 2-week initiative or 2-week sprint. So if you fail, if it doesn't work, and you have only blown or wasted 2 weeks worth of money, probably what you've also done, though, is learned a lot. And that may not be usable in the marketplace, but it may value and give you more common sense in what you're going to do next. And the next thing, of course, is to promote empiricism to the best possible outcomes. And empiricism simply means that you do something, then you look around, you figure out, given what you just did and given how everything's changed and given everything you've learned, given your failures, what are the next best things to do? So you're constantly innovating, you're constantly inspecting, you're constantly adapting. It's an empirical approach. And this is very different. The one on the left, waterfall, predictive, assumes that you know everything. On the right says, you may not know a lot, but you certainly do the best you can with what you can do. Typically, you can spot a Scrum organization because people look forward to coming to work there because they get to work with other people in an open, innovative environment. Now, there's a problem, and I ran into this at a Swiss insurance company where there were 3 different Scrum projects that were going on in the company, and they were really doing well, and their customers were delighted. And what they wanted to do was go and talk to their management and say, hey, we're doing this, what we need to do. We think we ought to spread this throughout the entire organization. Now, what I suggested to them was not to say a word, just keep succeeding, keep doing well. Others would see it and adopt it, but don't try to get other people to change. And the reason for that is the people who are thinking in a waterfall or traditional mode are not going to value or welcome your approach. And I saw this at one company I'm working with where I'm introducing Scrum to their senior management, and a guy who's in charge of QA says, hey, this is going to change my job, isn't it? And the moment he realized that, he was going to slow everything down. He wanted to be careful. He didn't want anything that was radical that was going to change the way in which he planned to feed his family and get his kids to school and to retire. So when you mix a culture of people who are innovating and taking risk and failing and collaborating and being open with people who want to be certain and people who want to be careful and people who want to you not to expose things that could embarrass them, when you mix a culture like that, you will have conflict. And so you've got to do this sort of change in a very careful, very thoughtful way. The thing that allows you to drive this change in mixing cultures is the radical success and value that comes from building products using Scrum. And that's a tremendous motivator because it means you can stay alive. However, many organizations that I've worked with, Scrum basically gets surrounded by traditional organizations. They say, well, you know, we use a PMO to assign staff based on who's available. And, oh, we use a QA organization at the end to test your quality, so just build it as fast as you can. So you find a mixture of thinking that is often confusing and dilutes the value you can get from Scrum, at the same time kind of screwing up the old waterfall approach. So what you see is the waterfall culture bleeding into Scrum projects. And what you then see is your effort to gain agility being diluted. I've had many projects, many products where I've helped people be very, very successful. I've worked with many organizations where they start from scratch with an agile initiative, and they are an agile company, and they do very, very well. I've had successes in companies that are traditional and that bring Scrum in, become agile, but then if the person driving it, trying to make it happen, leaves, gets promoted, it tends to start withering. It tends to disappear. So this change is not simple. The change to an industrial age was not simple. The change to an innovative, complex society and set of products like we have now is not simple. And what you're doing is just starting on the journey. So there is something that I did want to mention to you, because a lot of people think, well, you know, the traditional IT organization or traditional software development organization really is, I don't like the way they think, they're wrong. You've got to remember that most organizations have systems that were built a long time ago and have persisted for a long time. And waterfall and traditional processes have been used to enhance them, to maintain them, to sustain them. And without them, the company is often in deep trouble. And so we often want to sustain and maintain a traditional IT capability using traditional approaches, because that's the only way you can keep those systems stable. You don't want to take something that's critical and yet pretty fragile and try using new processes on it just, you know, because it's a new process. You may want to use it on new innovations. Now, there are four, you know, I've helped spread Scrum to a lot of organizations. I've worked with a lot of people who've done it also. And I've, across time, categorized ways in which people adopt Scrum into four categories. And the first, I think we just talked about a little, is using and spreading Scrum within an existing organization. So this is an organization that maybe uses waterfall, and they now want to use Scrum. They want to be agile. The second is, that actually is a kind of hard way of doing it. So what they want to do is instead become agile overnight, because, you know, there are a lot of things that are possible, and hard work isn't necessarily something you want. So what they've heard is, and what they're available to do, is to go buy agility. So someone comes and knocks on the door, salesman says, hey, I hear you want to be agile. I can sell it to you, and we'll come in, and in 12 months, you'll be agile, and you'll be a hero, you'll be a success, and thank you very much. So that's an approach. The third approach is actually relatively straightforward, but it takes time. And this is taking your current organization and assessing it, looking at it, and bit by bit, continuously improving it until it does what you want. Because the whole thing is a cost-benefit trade-off. You want agility, you want innovative ability, you want efficiency, but, you know, it's a lot of work. So this is a way of focusing your work on the most important things first. And the fourth way is using a completely separate organization, or maybe even an organization within your organization that is insular. It's isolated from the traditional way of doing it. And that is where you do your innovative work. So four different approaches. The first, so here's a traditional organization.
Yeah.
Looks familiar. It's got a CIO, CTO, VP, whatever the primary title is. And then it's based by products, based by business functions, broken down by functional managers. It's got a DBA group, a PMO, a QA infrastructure. It's got all of these people who come to work and know their jobs and know what to do, and stuff gets through in a traditional way. And you then have Scrum projects going on also, and these are also in a different way churning out value, but they're different from the traditional organization. And here, the way I first saw this happen is a business person whose IT group was using Scrum was at a party, and he said, "You're not going to believe what he saw today," to one of his friends. He said, "Why?" He said, "I saw, you know, we've only been going at this for about a month, and I saw some working software that I can start putting out to my customers." And he said, "Oh, come on." And he said, "So this is the way it spreads. People see the possibility of doing things that are of value rapidly, and then they want to go back into the traditional organization and say, hey, you do that too." And then what you have is the use and spread of Scrum within the traditional organization, driven by the demand for value and innovation and for effectiveness. The reality when you have that type of situation is something called water Scrum fall. And there was a group called Forrester that went out and assessed and interviewed a lot of organizations that were using Scrum, and they came up with this phrase. And what they found was you had a kind of confused mess where some traditional practices were being used, some Scrum practices are being used, but by and large, they weren't getting the benefits that they anticipated, and instead they were actually creating problems that they hadn't had before. Because one of the bad things about Scrum, it's a little like bringing home a girlfriend to and introducing her to your parents, is you get immediate feedback. And when you use Scrum, what happens is you immediately find out how things are working in the organization, and you start getting some turmoil. Like the guy in charge of QA who said, "This is going to change my job, isn't it?" Or the vice president of engineering says, "Well, you need some staff. I'll bring over in the PMO organization, and they'll help you." So what you wind up with is neither agile nor traditional and predictive, but something that's kind of halfway in between and is profoundly frustrating. When someone says, "I'd like you to come see my organization," and I'll walk into the place where they develop their software, you can tell if it's this situation because it is usually dead quiet. People have their heads down. They are demoralized. They are usually depressed because they don't quite know what to do. Okay, so that's common, but not necessarily desirable. The second approach, which many, many organizations do, is if they've reached that sort of stasis, that situation in which they've got Scrum and traditional going on at the same time, is it's very frustrating. So someone comes up to them and says, "Hey, I've got a great approach. What you can do is buy this from us, and you put this in. We'll come in, we'll train all your people, give them new titles and all this, and you will be an agile organization." So what you're basically doing is pasting an agile approach on top of your current organization. And what happens is you have a situation like this, where what you're doing is you have your traditional organization and you paste something on top of it. The example I have here is SAFe. That's a new way of doing things that they paste on top of a traditional organization. But the problem is that the traditional organization's values bleed through. So they might be suppressed, submerged for a while, but the thing about, well, I can't really let my failures show. Well, I can't really stop watching my boss to make sure I get promoted. Well, I can't really, you know, all of those values bleed through, and what happens when they bleed through is you still have a mess, you still have mixed values, but you've probably wasted a year and a lot of money mixing up things a little bit more. The example I thought of with this, where someone said you can just buy a new way of doing Agile, is it's like when the United States brought democracy to Iraq by pasting it on top of the current culture. Strangely enough, I still wouldn't describe Iraq as a democracy, even though there was huge effort involved. I used to work with Coopers and Lybrand, one of the big accountancies and consulting firms, and they had a methodology. And I was in one of their training classes, and I was listening to some project managers, and they're listening to the way you're going to build software using that approach. And one of them said to the other, so we have to do this and build software? And that's a little like buying one of these new approaches and getting trained and all that on it, is you think that that will do it for you, but you know in your heart that it's just extra work. Someone's going to benefit, but probably not you and probably not your customers. So I tend not to, when an organization's going through this, I tend to wait until they have their moment of reckoning and they come awake and then see how I can help them out. So the third approach, and this has been reasonably successful in many organizations. I think you've seen this at Philips in parts of it in the United States, is to do continuous improvement. That is, you have a goal, and that is to build software iteratively and incrementally. You have a goal, which is to do the most valuable things first, second, third, fourth. You have a goal, which is to empower your employees and take their ideas and use their ideas and have them take on doing the work. And you have all these goals, but that's not the way you're structured. So what this does is it puts in techniques for working that way bit by bit by bit, continuous improvement while you're changing the way you work, and at the same time that you're doing the continuous improvement, monitoring what the impact is. Because you just don't do a change and it automatically succeeds. A lot of changes that you make slide off, and you have to come back and say, why did that fail, and look at it again and try it again. Now, this type of approach characteristics is it's built on top of the teams that are already using Scrum. So you do it with teams that are already using Scrum, and see how you can make them more effective. It is continuous improvement. It doesn't expect that you're going to be perfect or great up front. It assumes that you have goals and you want to reach those goals. It assumes that you're actually measuring and monitoring and watching what you're doing. So you're measuring. And that it's iterative incremental. You do a bit, you inspect how it worked, then you do a bit more, and you may have failures, you may have to go back and do it again. That it's self-organizing, that the people doing this type of change, this type of new ways of building software, are going to maybe change the way they do things, change the way you do things, so that they can be better. DevOps is certainly one of the outcomes of that sort of thing, where everyone realized, oh my God, if we're going to do this, we really have to get development and operations much more closely aligned. And this encourages transparency and visibility, and it's emergent. So this type of approach, this third approach, means that from the very top of the organization, they have decided that they are going to be more innovative, that they need to be more efficient, that they need to be more competitive. And they are going to give you support or give the group that's actually making this change, this continuous improvement, support. Because without this support, all those other people who are still working from the old value stream are going to find ways to undercut you. So you need top-down support. And what you need to do as you're doing this is base your change on bottom-up intelligence. That is, you have a team of people who actually know how things work in your organization and who actually do the work in your organization, looking and seeing what they can do to improve the way they do it within a Scrum framework. So they're going to be continuously looking at what tools they could use, how they could work together better, how QA could be changed, what sort of new techniques they've heard of. They're going to be trying all things. And it starts within maybe one Scrum team and goes to many Scrum teams and maybe spreads from one product to another product. Often what we see with this is that you find very, very close collaboration between the line of business, the product that makes that line of business competitive, and the development teams that make it happen. So top-down support, critical, but not top-down direction and saying, you are going to do it, you're going to be agile, and this is how you're going to be agile. But instead saying, we need this sort of innovative capability. We will do whatever we can to help you, and we need some transparency in what's going on. This is just a good graphic of this approach. And it says evidence-based. So the first thing you do is you measure how things are going. Like a measurement might be, how many defects do you generate per, let's say, $100,000 or 100,000 euros that you expend? Another might be, how rapidly can you put out an increment of working functionality and have it available to the users? So make a measurement of some sort, small, big, whatever, but a measurement. And based on that measurement, the measurement is on something that you're having problems with. Make sure it's a good measurement. And then go inspect, in the way you're doing your work, what are some probable causes for the measurement being not what you wish it would be. So you're going to come up with some assumptions. You're going to come up with some ideas about what you can do to improve that measurement, to improve that situation. And what you're going to do then, and this is where you know, you're working in the teams that are building the software, is you're going to adapt. You're going to change the way you do things. And it's not going to be a massive change. This is a bit-by-bit change. This is not going to be an overnight change. This is going to be change this one set of things that you think are causing this situation to occur, and let's see if it gets better. So what you're doing is you're envisioning what things you might do that would cause you to work differently, and then you're going to make that adaptation, and then you're going to go back and measure and see if things improved. Now, measurements often create some lagging indicators, so often you may not see the change have an impact for months, but you know, this is you making an assertion and putting down something you're tracking. So again, we're measuring, then we're measuring something that's causing trouble, and then we're inspecting what we think is likely to be causing that problem, identifying what those areas are. We're envisioning what we could do differently that could improve that situation, improve the metrics for the situation, and then we're making that adaptation, a sprint review. What a great place for doing this. In this next sprint, we're going to be trying this, except maybe at an organizational level. And we're going to make the adaptation, and then we're going to set this aside, and we're going to keep measuring this. And then we're going to go ahead and maybe try the next thing that we think is a problem. But what you've got is a whole bunch of ongoing change efforts where you're trying to make things better bit by bit by bit. And this is an evidence-based improvement cycle. And again, I'm calling evidence-based because you're not just doing it and hoping. You have some numbers, you have some metrics that you are counting on. The last approach, and sometimes the third approach leads to this. Sometimes this is an initiative taken up front, which is the organization says, well, we're really good at what we do now. If we're going to have a separate innovative organization, we're going to make it a completely separate organization. Or what sometimes happens is that the business funds and finances and sources one of those within itself. So in this type of situation, what you have is there is a second organization in addition to your traditional development organization, which is devoted to the design and implementation of an agile strategy. And it's going to use an agile network-like set of structures, and a very different set of processes, Scrum processes, modern engineering practices, modern engineering tools, that are different from what you use in the rest of the organization. And your intention here may not be spreading this throughout the organization. Your intention may be one critical area. For instance, when they started shutting down the nuclear plants, they needed a whole bunch of innovative ways for putting in smart grid. And so they started looking at this whole idea of having separate innovative organizations developing the smart grid products. And this is a different approach. This is not necessarily saying we're going to try to change exactly everything of where we are. It's saying most of that is fine. What we've got is a critical problem or need over here, and we're going to build a separate organization that has separate values, separate principles that does this. And it may either be within the business or maybe like a subcontractor to the business. And we consider that a duopoly. So you've got two things going on at once. And it evolves. It may spread to the rest of the organization, but the intention is not necessarily organizational change, but to provide organizational capability rapidly. And across time, because this tends to speak for itself, the benefits tend to speak for itself, the older ways of doing things tend to wither away, except for like maintaining the old legacy software where you really need it. And bit by bit, everything comes over and starts working in this new organization. And so you have your traditional organization, and you have, I often refer to it as a studio, where you are doing things in an agile way, where you're innovative. You've got an agile culture. It's very product-oriented rather than project-oriented. It handles everything from planning through operating the software that is built, the products that are built. It has all the existing services, such as personnel is such an actually bad word, human resources worse, but it's got people management within it. How do you handle hiring people? It's got it's got capability for onboarding new products that want to start using this. It uses value-based measurement. It doesn't care whether you meet the date that you said you would for the money you said you would. Instead, it matters, cares about the value and the competitiveness that you bring to the organization. So this is a very different approach, and takes a while to do, but what it tends to do is not mix up the traditional way with the new way as much as the other approaches. Now, the third way that I talked about with the continuous improvement, empirical improvement based on evidence, is certainly a way of doing it, but you are changing, you are intending to change the entire organization. So you're continually assessing the impact of the changes on everyone. So a bit more difficult, a bit more ambitious, but certainly has been done. One of my favorite places for watching that being done was at Cisco. The third approach has been done in a lot of organizations. By a lot, I mean more than 10. I tend to reduce my horizon of success to the possible. So it's been done, and it works. And many of the people in the academics or in academic world are starting to espouse this approach because they're saying the traditional organization is good at what it does. Don't break it. You want to do something a new way that gives you more competitive advantage? Try something new. So both ways, all ways, what you need is someone to drive this who has authorization from the very top, who has the top standing behind them, because this will cause emotions, this will cause people to be distressed, this will cause people to be joyous, this will cause bits of craziness. You need someone at the top to stand behind it and say, are we going the direction we want? Is this making the things that we want, the goals that we have, occur and backing the actual work that's happening? And then what it needs is a group of people in the organization who actually know Scrum, know Agile, who have experienced this before, who are driving this type of change through an organization. So some takeaways that you may want to take from this organization, from this presentation, is becoming an innovative organization that competes effectively requires the values and the principles that are laid out in the Agile Manifesto. Those were very generic. Those were very loosely stated so that they are applicable whether you're building software, whether you're looking at it, making a whole new way of an organization, of a community using energy. Another is that Scrum is a great starting point to gain agility. Rather than trying to think through everything yourself, like you sit down across from someone else and say, let's play a game, and they say, oh yeah, what game? You say, chess. And you say, well, we'd like to become agile. Oh, how do you want to do this? Well, let's try Scrum. So it's a starting point. However, using Scrum in a traditional organization which is used to a different way of building software requires a careful, mediated change effort. It's driven from the top, supported from the top. It has continuous improvement based on real evidence of benefits occurring, and the actual work is done from the bottom of the organization by the workers up. And if you look over into the lean world, you'll see something very, very similar being done. So the really great news is that's it. I have covered a lot of ground, and I've purposefully not gone into details because any one of these topics could spend weeks, hours, days, whatever. So we purposefully left some time at the end where we can have...
Yes, Ken, thank you very much. We already given you a round of applause, so thanks for your story, and I hope it inspired the audience. What I have here in my
hopefully
hand...
it didn't scare them.
Scare them? Yeah, maybe. We will see based on the questions that the audience is now able to fire to you. So in order to make that a success, we have a beautiful orange box here. It's called a chat box or bubble box in Dutch. And we're going to try if people talk into this square, if you can hear it, Ken, in America. Some basic rules of using this thing. Don't hold it here, but a little bit more up, please. So really talk into the black area of the orange square. And then we will see if it will reach Boston. So who would like to state the first question to Ken Schwaber? Yes. Okay. That would be okay. There we go. It's very soft, no hard stuff, so don't worry. Oh, it's gone. Yeah. Okay. Try it.
Hi, Mr. Schwaber. Thank you very much for your presentation. That was really great. Many leaders bought Agile. Due to the fact that they think they kind of been promised to deliver twice as much in half the time, as you know. So my question to you is, what do we say to those leaders?
What do you say to those?
To those leaders who bought Agile because of the promise of twice as much in half the time being delivered.
So they bought an Agile approach and...
For efficiency reasons.
For efficiency reasons. A good question to them with buying anything is, are you doing better or worse, and how do you know? So there's a very critical thing, which is to measure progress or regression from your goal. So if they say we want to be agile, one good measurement is how rapidly can we put out a piece of functionality that works and is viable in the marketplace? And if that doesn't improve, interesting, there's a problem. Another measurement that we often use is how satisfied are the customers? And so, you know, you can just do that by going out to 10 different customers and saying, with this area where we've been using this new approach, are you more satisfied in working with us? And you can also ask the same question of the developers, of the employees of your organization. Given this, are you happier working here? Is this a better place to be? If someone came in from another organization and offered you 10,000 euros more to work for them, would you leave? Or is this such an exciting, innovative place to work that we couldn't lose you? So really critical thing is to have them not blindly buy something and then hope that things will improve, but to actually establish some measurements and then see if you make progress toward them.
Okay, thank you, Ken. Is your question answered?
Yes, thank you very much.
Okay, you're so okay. Yeah, I deserve it. Thank you. We can also play the rule by just somebody else stands up or puts up a hand and then throw it to each other. So that does not necessarily have to be me. But so who's next? Who's got a question for Ken?
I wish you would take a picture of someone talking into an orange box.
Yes. Shall we do that? I will do that and we'll make sure it comes down to you. Although from here it looks like you can see it perfectly, but yeah. Okay, so it was over there. Okay, I will throw it to you and then take a picture for Ken. There we go.
Hi, Mr. Schwaber. I have a question.
Hello.
I see a lot of bad implementations of Agile, but I also see that Agile is being implemented in other branches than IT. So I'm really curious, where do you think that Agile will be in 5 or 10 years?
So the population, this actually indicates a bit of my age, was about 3 billion people when I was born, and it's now 7.4 billion. Companies work via international global supply chains. They use things like CRM systems to monitor and manage things. The amount of data that's in play is incredible. I don't think the word agility is necessarily a word that's of interest. I think if we don't act in new ways that we are seeing with companies that say they're agile and that are approaching things this way, the world isn't going to work. The change, the way we're doing things differently, is forcing agility. You're sitting now in a wonderful, wonderful country called the Netherlands, and the water is rising around you. And boy, I hope you guys are agile. We actually, in the United States, are bringing some of your engineers to New York, to New Orleans, where we have the same issues. So we live in a very, very complex, chaotic, unstable world. And all of the ideas in agility are an approach toward living in that world as successfully as possible. So I not only think it'll be around, I think people will have found new ways of using it that have to be the basis of their thought process.
Okay, does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Yes. I like that one. Yeah, throw it to somebody. Let's see. So who also got a question for Ken? No one. No one. It's one of the creators of Scrum. Yeah, good. Well, that's an easy throw. Yes, very well.
First of all, thank you so much for your presentation. I have a question about when doing an agile transformation, which involves a pretty big organization. Which scaling concept would you recommend and why?
Which what?
Scaling.
Which scaling framework would you recommend to the audience here in the Netherlands, Ken?
So, Scrum itself, when I used it initially, I would work with small teams, small product areas. I worked with teleradiology, with bringing informatics to medical practices. And I would modulate it, change it, modify it, so it fit the context and the needs of the group that I was working with. Because Scrum itself, you know, like chess, is just a very small thing. Hard to understand and support, but there it is by itself. So one of the fascinating questions I often get is someone says, well, we have this project and we want to use Scrum. And what we're struggling with is, how do we use Scrum if we have 900 people? And of course, my question to them is, how do you know you need 900 people? No possible way. So for a scaling approach, I wrote a couple of books with ideas about it. But what everyone wanted was solutions. That is, I want to go to a class, I want to hire someone, I want them to tell me how to scale Scrum. And I still don't necessarily prescribe a way of scaling it organizationally. However, we have an approach that's at the company I'm working with now, scrum.org, called Nexus, which is a way of scaling multiple Scrum teams into product development. And it can get as big as you want. And the issue, as you go from one Scrum team to two Scrum teams to three Scrum teams, is that you start creating dependencies. One team needs to do something before another team can get their work done, and another team has to get something else done before another team gets it done. And these dependencies can overwhelm your Scrum teams, your developers. And you'll find the developers can spend 70-80% of their time going back and forth, working with each other to resolve who's going to do what so the whole product still works. So I wanted a couple dependencies were the issue, and you needed a way to resolve them. Second was that the way to ensure that you had resolved your dependencies, that regardless of how many Scrum teams are working on this product in this product release, at the end of every sprint, there was a complete integrated working increment. Because the symptom of failed dependencies is the product doesn't work. So that means you got to go back and start looking again at where you failed. The other thing that this does bring to the fore is the whole idea of microservices, architecture, and infrastructure being in place with standards that all of these teams conform to minimize the dependencies that they'll run into. So this implies that you have an architecture infrastructure group, that you have services that they can take advantage of for, let's say, user interface or data access, which minimize the dependencies. Now, of course, the flip side to that is then you start constraining your agility. However, depends on, you know, everything depends, right? It's an approach. You can look it up at scrum.org, www.scrum.org, Nexus, and it's got a pretty good definition of it. But again, it requires you to be thoughtful.
Okay, thank you, Ken. So basically what you say is the answer to the question, which scaling framework to use, the one that you have actually developed. So that's pretty clear, I guess. We've got still some time left. Maybe if I just go to here. Yeah, there. let's see. Yes, there's somebody else. There.
Okay. Thank you. Let's say that there are two companies. Company A, the workers really want to work agile, but management doesn't see the benefits yet. And company B is management really want to work agile, but the workers don't see the benefits yet. Which one of them would be most likely to succeed, according to you?
Wow, I love these types of A-B choices. So the management doesn't necessarily want to go agile, doesn't see the benefit. What the workers need to do is not ever tell them that they're being agile. Never tell them they're using Scrum. Just do stuff differently and let management bask in the vast success that accrues to them and their organization. So that's helping management see a new way of doing things. In the second thing, where the developers, where the IT, where the development organization doesn't want to try something new, what you have, it's what sounds like, is a vast amount of distrust. Scrum will not work without trust, because trust is the basis of openness, willingness to fail, willingness to try different things. So somehow you have to get a small start where people can see that they can try to work differently and not be punished. I remember at the end of a sprint in a more traditional organization, the team had estimated that they would get, let's say, 40 things done, and they got 33 things done. And the product owner, more very traditional product management, came in and he spent the entire time berating them, making them feel terrible because they hadn't done what they said they would. That's a tremendous way to reduce and lose trust. The more appropriate thing would be, nice going, guys, you got 33 things done. That's really phenomenal. And at that point, he can figure out or she can figure out whether proceeding is cost-effective or not. But this is who the people are. You don't spend your time berating people. You don't spend your time losing their trust. Instead, you spend your time seeing how you can do the most valuable things possible.
Okay, thank you for your clear answer.
Okay, good. Good. Who's next?
I like these A-B questions.
You like A-B questions? Yes.
Yes, thank you.
On your left. Maybe it will... Oh. The box is out of the room, but no problem.
Well, first of all, I'm a lousy catcher, so sorry for that. The boxes flew over my head. And I'm also sorry, I don't have an A-B question for you, so I apologize for that. But I have sort of the best memory question for you, because I can imagine that you have a really broad and really deep experience. You've seen and heard and experienced a lot. So if I would ask you, which moment are you the most proud of or is will stuck in your memory as a moment that you knew this fits? This is what Scrum Agile was made for.
Okay, so you took a couple of sharp turns in your question. Can the moderator rephrase it for me?
There's some laughing going on here, Ken. I would like the person who asked the question to rephrase it, if that's okay. Can you please do it again?
Which moment pops up in your head the first as a really proud moment, a memorable moment of something about Scrum that you've experienced? Did you think this is what it was made for in your experience?
I made it, and so I made Scrum and Jeff made Scrum because we had software companies which were trying to succeed in hugely complicated environments. We were using new object-oriented technologies. We're using small talk environments. We were, you know, just, and our customers were wanting this and wanting that. And so lots and lots of problems. So Scrum, the heart of Scrum for me is software. And I love software development. To me, there's nothing more fun than writing and debugging a program. I'm weird in that way. So to me, Scrum's home is always software. However, I have seen over and over again it being used in situations for other complex situations like marketing programs. A friend of mine's daughter was a teacher at an inner city, very, very challenged school in Philadelphia. And the kids who were there were by and large hopeless. They you know, didn't have much of a future. They didn't see much of a future for themselves. And so just teaching them was kind of useless. So what his daughter did is would set up with the kids at the start of the week a weekly goal. And then have them lay out a plan for what they would do to try to accomplish that goal. Now, this would be in addition to everything else. And then at the end of the week, see how they had done toward reaching the goal and what they could have done differently toward doing it. So what they were doing was empowering the children to take control of their own lives rather than feeling helpless and hopeless. So, you know, that's Scrum.
Wow, thanks for your answer, Ken. Yes, and it's been appreciated, okay. I see, over
yes,
here.
Yes, I don't know if it, the mic still works. Thank you very much for your answer.
Yeah. Okay, good one.
You're welcome.
Good one. So, I see a question over here. And, yeah, so, good. There comes another one. Take it away.
You recently added a number of values to the Scrum Guide. I was wondering what considerations made you add those values to the guide?
There are two answers I can give you. One is the politically acceptable one, which will make me sound profoundly insightful and deeply thoughtful. And the other is what really happened.
Yes, the last one, please.
if you look at the second Scrum book I wrote, Agile Software Development with Scrum, Agile Project Management with Scrum, I have the values stated there and why they're important. And Kent Beck in Extreme Programming had also listed values. And so Jeff's and I put up the Scrum guide online with a way of people making suggestions on how it could be enhanced so it was of more value to them. And the number one request was, can you take the Scrum values that are in the second book and put them into the Scrum guide so people have a specific set of values, and to the extent that they're a little different from the Agile values, that they can make sure that they adhere to. So they were there. I did them because Kent Beck had done them. And then they were requested by everyone. And so we put them in. So no deep thinking, just sprang from experience.
Cool.
Okay, thank you very much for your answer.
Yeah, sounds a little bit of based on customer feedback, I would say. So that's in itself could be very Scrummish, I would say. Thank you.
Yeah, and if you go to the Scrum Guide website, you'll see that user voice thing where you can put in requests for things.
Good. Okay, we have another question?
Yes.
Good.
Hello, Mr. Schwaber. Thank you for joining us. My question is, from your example from the school, I take that you are positive about complying Scrum to business contexts, but what's your vision to applying that on an integrated context, so business and IT, especially when IT is very traditional and traditional IT environment?
Well, we've seen this. My best example of that is in the United States, is at Philips Lighting, where they know that they need efficiency, and efficiency implies lean, and that's value chain management. That's all sorts of principles that aren't necessarily specific to Scrum, but they need to build new products that the business can use and apply and sell and put into their value chain and put into their supply chain. So often what we see business functions doing is having development groups within them, and they're combinations of both the business people and the IT people or development people. An example might be a new banking system that they're going to use. And they build it within that group, and they get feedback from everyone in the business. And then the business part rolls it out and manages it. So business functions are superb at managing very efficiently high volume work. Scrum is very, very good at building value in an iterative incremental way. So they work together, but they're not applied to the same thing.
Okay. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Yes, it does. Good. Good. Okay. Something in between. I got some text messages, Ken, on my phone, which asked me, that bottle of water standing on stage over there, is that yours, Ken, or is it just here on stage?
Is it just me on stage?
Yeah, are you like kicking the bottle of water with your right foot over, or is it here on our stage? Wow. Very well. Just then we have that cleared up.
I didn't kick it over. That's very good.
Yeah. So that's risk has been solved now. Good. We are doing good. So maybe some other questions from the audience who would like to.
One last following on mine.
You've got a follow-up question last one.
Yeah.
If that's okay with Brief everybody, I'm fine. Yeah, take it.
I had one question on the answer you gave to me. Does that mean that the business people are not actually applying Scrum?
So I am known for never answering a question directly. Okay? If you look at a sales organization, they were the initial group that did Scrum. They set an annual goal for their revenues, right? And they build a pipeline of prospects that are going to bring in that money. And then they send the salesman out, and the salesman goes selling, and they focus on those that are of the highest likelihood to bring in value. They might also be building a future, things that they can do, but they work on an iterative, incremental basis to maximize value. So the whole approach of iterative, incremental, working against a product backlog to maximize value, inspecting and adapting, and counting on the people to do the work and doing everything you can to help them, is very widespread. Scrum is simply a very direct implementation of it for software. And for elsewhere, if you need some more framework to do it.
Yeah?
Thank you.
Okay, we're satisfied. Thanks. Okay. Whew. We have until 5. I don't have a clue what time it is. Shall we do one last question? 5 minutes? Good.
One last question.
One last question? The final one. Okay, hit it.
Thank you for the presentation, Mr. Schwaber. I got a question about...
You're welcome.
Thank you. About Scrum Guide, the last change you made. everybody was expecting that something like the definition of ready and the refinement session itself will be in it. Why didn't you choose to put it in the guide, and why did you and Jeff leave it out there?
So when I look at the things that are asked for, it's things that people are struggling with in using Scrum. So like a definition of a ready product backlog item, or a definition of a ready increment, or things like this. And the problem that we have is, it goes back to the question just before this, which is Scrum and its usage. It's used in many, many, many different contexts. And any answer that I would give would restrain Scrum's usage to those contexts. So I try to leave it open so that you have to figure out how to apply it given the circumstance that you're in. So ready for a very, very sophisticated, knowledgeable group of developers that are working closely with the business is very different from ready for a new group of developers that are contractors who are working with business people who don't really know what they want yet. So I don't want to try constraining it to one situation. And that's why, you know, the classic phrase in Scrum is, it depends.
Okay, thank you, Ken. And with those famous words, I would like to end this Q&A with you. Thank you very much. Let's give Ken one last big hand of applause. And shall we try to do a wave? Just a wave to Ken? Ken?
And thank you.
We wave from the Netherlands all to you. And we say bye-bye. Okay, thank you. There he is. Okay, cool. So. Wow. Wie vond dit cool, zo'n hologram? Was leuk, hè? Ik heb dit dus echt nog nooit meegemaakt. Ik ben echt helemaal blown away. Ik vind het fantastisch. Ik hoop dat jullie er ook van hebben genoten. En dit is natuurlijk wel altijd een beetje zo het moeilijkste moment van zo'n event, hè? Want ik weet niet of jullie het hele programma al hebben gezien, maar ja, we hebben ook nog iets als een borrel. En het enige wat, laten we zeggen, tussen nu en de borrel staat is de tijd die ik nu ga gebruiken. Ik zal jullie helpen om het te proberen echt zo kort mogelijk te houden. Wat ik in ieder geval wel in die tijd wil gaan doen, is jullie nog één keer aandacht vragen voor het geven van feedback. Om alvast te oefenen, denk even 3 seconden na over welke sessie of welke titel van de sessie je het allerleukste vond. En na 3 seconden ga ik aftellen en dan schreeuwen we die naam 1 keer heel hard door de zaal. Ja, dus denk even kort na. Ja? In 3, 2, 1, roept u maar. Het was allemaal te gek. Mooi, dank jullie wel. Lever je badge in, hè? Dus vul beide kanten even in. Dat helpt ons weer voor een volgende keer. Bij waar je binnen bent gekomen kun je de kaartjes ook achterlaten. Als je het heel fijn vindt, je keycord mag je lekker mee naar huis nemen. Denk ook aan de stands, want er staan ook allemaal leuke goodies en dingen. Blijf ook nog even lekker hangen. Dat doen wij samen met, samen met de collega's van Prowareness doen wij dat ook nog even. Kunnen we nog een beetje napraten als jullie dat leuk vinden met een hapje en een drankje. Dank in ieder geval allemaal alvast voor jullie komst. En ik hoop dat jullie ervan hebben genoten. Tot snel!